is an Unspoiled Network podcast.
This is Unspoiled, covering the Dresden Files, Book 13, Ghost Story.
Why?
Just to perk us all up. Chapters 31, 32, and 33. In these chapters, we finally get to meet He Walks Behind. He's not a nice man. Welcome to Unspoiled. I'm a rolling thunder, pouring rain. I'm coming down like a hurricane. My lightning's flashing across the sky. You're only young, but you're gonna die. I won't take no prisoners, once with no lies. Nobody's putting up a fight. I got my bill, I'm gonna take you to hell. I'm gonna get ya, sick, get ya, I'll help
you. I like your liberal use of the word man here.
Yeah, manling? Man-ish? Man thing. I think man thing.
I don't care for that one at all. Let's do the opposite of that.
So, Rashawn, what did you think of this? This whole reveal, this memory.
It was unexpected. Because when you're reading it and you're just thinking about how upset Harry is, he's devastated, this thing that has happened, his life is like, you know, upside down. Mm-hmm. And then the desperate kind of like, I'm going to rob a gas station. It just didn't feel like we were going in the direction we ended up going.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely.
And it was him, it was worse than I even imagined.
Yeah, he sucks.
He really, really sucks you. That is an accurate assessment. Like, just, it was so fucking creepy.
Mm-hmm.
When Harry, he feels it, like, behind him.
Mm-hmm.
But then you turn around and it's not there. And then later on when we find out how he actually gets around, and every time you turn around, he's just, like, right at your fucking back. Oh, guys.
I love the part when Harry just starts spinning around wildly, making Pee Wee Herman noises as he escapes them. Like, great plan, buddy. I mean, it worked, kind of.
Oh,
so,
my God.
I can't even be that mad, but also...
I say, hats off, young man. Because, if nothing else... He Who Walks did not know what the fuck to do with him.
I mean, like, that's fair. That's fair.
He was like, you know, part really interested in this weird little man.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know, like, just behaving in a way that I guess the most of his victims behave. And then also Harry with the smart aleck.
Oh, my God.
Bit. You know, like, yeah. This feels like... Because I'm sure he didn't talk that way to Justin.
Oh, 100%
right?
Did not, yeah.
So this is probably the first time this is coming out of him. We're getting a Harry Dresden shtick, you know? And it was really cool to see that kind of how that comes. And, like, Fuego, too, you know, like, mm-hmm. where that comes from. The whole thing, it was aces.
Yeah, so when I have... you know, brought up in the past frequently, how people who don't like this book are wrong.
I keep forgetting that you tell me that that is a thing because it is so banana pants.
This is really what I'm almost always thinking about when I say that, because to me, this bit of his history is so important and revealing and strange that I just feel like it changes a lot about the way you understand Harry.
Mm-hmm.
really getting to see for, it's one thing to be like, yeah, I grew up in the system. It was hard. I had people I couldn't rely on. It's another thing to see how this went down.
Oh,
you know,
when he starts talking about how this is all his fault because, you know, no one ever stays. He says something like, no one has ever given more than an inch to help him, you know, or be there. It's heartbreaking because he is feeling all of this self-loathing and blaming himself for whatever Justin had planned. And then he starts kind of lashing out about Elaine, how she just sat there, and the betrayal he feels. It's a lot.
I like the main thing that I always remember is him being like, I should have known better. I should have realized. I can't believe that I, like, fell for this.
Yeah.
And that, to me, is the worst part when somebody, like, betrays you and you've been hurt before and you let yourself think that things are changing. That feeling of being vindicated in your worst suspicions of what the world really is.
Yeah.
It's something that, like, maybe you can shake that. Eventually, but that's not, that is a moment that I think gets ingrained in your mind in a way that it's so much harder to come back from after something like that.
We have like these dual expectations, right? Like we tell people all the time how important it is to like forgive and let go of, you know, various types of trauma or harm that's been done to you because you're just holding yourself back from, like, the fulfillment of what life could offer you. That's right. What they tell us. But then, if you open yourself back up and you get hurt again, the way you feel about yourself is like, I can't believe I fell for that shit twice. You know, it's like, so, I don't know, just, it's, but we get a good part, though, after the sadness.
Yeah, I just, like I said, I find this to be, like, really fascinating, and I don't understand how it doesn't take up more space in people's memory of the book. There's, it's just, for me, this is, like, a major moment when I think about the series, and, like, figuring out the way that things had been going in his life, not just in that this is how he grew up, but also like finding out that Justin had a plan as the Lanan, she says, he was clearly like molding you to be an enforcer. And the fact that he like picked Harry and Elaine specifically, the fact that the he who walks behind calls him child of the stars.
I was going to ask about that. Not that I was going to expect the real answer, but
yeah, I don't know if you remember that Lashiel called him Starborn.
I didn't remember the name. I remember that Lashiel tells Harry something about he who walks, like something about either what kind of creature he is or where he comes from. I forget, or maybe she tells him both. But I don't. I didn't remember that she called him Starborn. What does that mean?
Yeah. And the way that he who walks behind talks to him, for me, always struck like, I'm testing you. Well, for what? Like, the way that he's like, oh, there you are. And, oh, you're not as useless as you seemed at first. Useful for who? What the fuck are, what are you here for? It's just, I don't like it. It creeps me out. It makes me feel like it's he's assessing him for something that I don't get.
Right.
And I don't know what he's even doing here. Like, did Justin send him? Because it feels too coincidental.
He says that he calls Justin by name at one point. Like, I can see why he sent me after you or why he called. Something like that. Hang on, see if I can find it. Or maybe you'll find it faster.
You know what? Let's start at the beginning and we'll get there. I'm jumping all over the place. I just really, I stand this book a lot, very hard. And this is really the reason why is this section. Because I don't know. It's loaded with, like, hints and weird turns of phrase that I'm like, what is that? And makes me a little paranoid. And it's kind of insane to me, the patience that Butcher has had to wait until the 13th book to tell us the story of Harry breaking from Justin and the way that went.
It went so long that I had started to wonder if maybe he just wasn't going to be a part of the story in any real way.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's been a minute, and he's just never really factored in much. You know, we hear about Justin only in that Harry killed him in self-defense, and that's what put Harry in front of the White Council.
Right.
And, you know... But turns out I was mistaken, and of course he's going to be all over these books. Like, what was I even thinking?
I mean, we only get that bit with him, and then Harry runs. So you think we're going to get another memory of Justin?
I think that we're going to hear a couple of more things about Justin. I'm not sure if... I would imagine it would have to stay in Harry's past, but I don't make the rules, you know, but I feel like this isn't the last story that we're going to hear. Either we'll hear him talk about going to the White Council, or maybe we'll find out that Justin is, I still think he might show up. Like, he might not be dead.
I mean... Harry doesn't do anything to kill him. Like, we haven't seen him die. So, we could see the memory of Harry killing him, because that's supposed to be what got the White Council's attention. Is that Harry, like, killed his master and has to convince the Council that it was self-defense.
And Elaine is gone when that happens, right?
Yeah. She is not... She's, like, vanished. And he always thought, until he sees her again in, like, what, the fourth book or something, that she was in on it until she tells him, like, hi, no, he put the fucking whammy on me, you dodo.
You know what? I want to talk about the whammy for a second, because in this first section is when Harry is, you know, just feeling all that pain and loss. And he yells about how she just sat there.
Mm-hmm.
But when we are actually in that moment when he comes home and catches them, doesn't he tell us that she was, you know, under his control or enthralled or something?
No, he says that she's sitting there in a state that looked weird. She's, like, sitting very straight, and he thinks it's sort of strange, but she always sits that way when she has something important to say, whether it's, like... It's something sort of sarcastic or whatever. So he's waiting for her to, like, I think be a little bit sassy. And then instead she's like, come and sit with me. And he is like, what the fuck, girl? Because he can see the straitjacket sitting there as she's telling him to come and sit with her.
Oh, okay. All right. So then, yeah, that does make sense then.
Yeah.
All right. So... I think we get at least two more Justin stories.
Two more? Okay, what do you think those are then, two more?
Well, I agree with the death scene, which I hadn't thought about. So that one, and I think maybe something about what Harry did after it was over.
After what
was after over? He's killed Justin, yeah.
So how is that a Justin scene, if it's after he's killed him?
Oh. Damn it.
This does not feel thought through, ma'am.
I guess technically it's not. It's just a Justin's corpse story. Scene. All right.
All right, so chapter 31. Harry is running, and there's a mention here about how he and Elaine would run together so that they could go fuck and then pretend that they had just been running, and how they really thought they were masters of deception, even though he knows now that clearly just knew exactly right. what the fuck they were doing.
I love the detail that he says that they would actually go running so that it wouldn't be a lie.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Bless them.
excuse me.
And so he's able to run quite a ways before he has to come to a stop. And it's November. He's alone. He has just like the jacket on his back. Mm-hmm. And he's starving and he's realizing like, oh, fuck, I have no options here. I need money. And he decides that he is going to turn over a convenience store. Knock over. Okay. Yeah, turn down service. I don't know. So he decides that he's going to like. First of all, I have to read it because, like, I found this so funny, and I don't know why. I needed shelter, I needed food, blah, 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 blah. For lack of anything better to hide my face, I'd tied my sweaty t-shirt around my head in a sort of makeshift balaclava. I didn't have anything else to wear except my letter jacket, which seemed more or less like a screaming advertisement to make it simple for the cops to figure out my identity. There wasn't much I could do except to rip all the patches off of it and hope for the best. Harry.
This is a... First of all, I have to say, when he decides to rob that convenience store, I was shocked.
Were you?
I was, and I do not know why. But I did not see it coming even a little bit. It was so strange. And I really felt like, Harry.
This is just like that detail for me that he rips the patches off. This is a classic Seinfeld situation. Turn it inside out. What are you doing? No, instead I'll let it get ruined.
And, you know, I'll be walking around in a very identifiable jacket because it'll be, you know, have all these rips and shit on it.
Yeah. You know, I mean, even if you take the patches off something, if it's a letter jacket, they're still going to know what it is. Yeah, get out of here. Just fucking turn it inside out. And he goes and gets like a paper bag out of the trash and jams his hand into it so that he can pretend that there's a gun in there.
And then notices there's something, like, sticky in the bottom of the bag.
It's like, oh, mayo, gross.
He's got, like, his sweatshirt tied over his fucking face.
I can't.
And it's not a good moment for him.
If it weren't for the fact that Stan was stoned as fuck, I don't think that any other cashier would have, like, fallen for this. I think a cashier that, for example, somebody who actually owned the, like, gas station would have, like, pulled out their sawed-off shotgun and be like, you want to make something of it? But he just happened to get lucky.
At first, Stan doesn't seem to be, like, quite sure what's happening.
Yeah.
And then Harry, like, uses a spell to knock some stuff off of a counter or something.
He yells kabang. That's the spell, is he points and goes, kabang, kabang. Oh, sweetie.
And so then Stan is like, oh shit, you know, hold up. And, you know, he's getting the money, and it seems like, you know, Harry might get out of this, and Stan will be okay. And he starts to feel, like, this weird creepiness on the back of his neck.
Yeah.
Just like some kind of, like, gnarly something. But there's nothing there. And at that moment, I got really creeped out.
I love the detail of how that Sinistar game is like, no. Run! Run!
I hated that. I hated it. It was so upsetting to read.
I don't know why that gets me. I have read this book now like 4 times. And I always forget what that is for the first instant. And like often I'll listen to the audiobook. So out of nowhere, he just says, run in this voice. And I'm like, what the fuck? And then I'm like, oh, the game. I forgot. But it's really startling to me. I don't know. And it starts to, like, get more and more, like, sluggish and like, sinister sounding.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Ma'am.
Because of Harry's, like, power making the whole thing sort of collapse internally. So.
Oh, my God. When he's trying to fucking turn the lights off outside before he goes in, and he gets all the street lights and shit, and then he accidentally, like, fries the lights in the store and the freezer.
Oh, my God. He's just trying to, like, turn security cameras off, and the fucking block goes dark, and he's like, I guess that helps. Okay.
Oh, poor baby.
Indeed. God. So, this dude, Stan, is agreeing to be cooperative. This is what they say to do, right, man? The way he's voiced is so funny. What is it? Money in a bag, man. I'm supposed to do whatever you want, right? That's what the owners have told us cashiers, right? I'm supposed to give you the money. No argument, okay? I love that it's question marks, like... and this is when he actually sees the outline of He Who Walks Behind in the game, like, screen reflection. And the description of this dude...
This, oof. It's like human-shaped adjacent. And it's got some kind of tail and real big shoulders.
I'm gonna read this because for me, I feel like it's well written. It was huge. I mean, it was taller and broader than the door was. It was more or less humanoid. The proportions were wrong. The shoulders too wide, the arms too long, the legs crooked and too thick. It was covered in fur or scales or some scabrous fungal amalgamation of both. And its eyes were empty, angled pits of dim violet light. There was a creature from another world standing behind me. I could feel it. Every bit as real as Stan to every sense but my sight. I took a real effort to move my head enough to cast a single hurried glance over my shoulder. Nothing. Stan was shoveling various bits into a bag. The store was otherwise empty. I looked back at the reflection. The thing was 2 feet closer.
Nope.
And it was smiling. It had a head whose shape was all but obscured by growths, or lumpy scales, or matted fur. But beneath its eyes, I could see a mouth, too wide to be real, filled with teeth too sharp and serrated and yellow to belong to anything of this earth. That was a smile from Lewis Carroll's opium-inspired laudanum-dosed nightmares.
Whoa. It's quite a picture.
Mm-hmm.
And it is just grotesque enough. You know, it's not like so beyond that it's hard to picture.
Yeah,
know?
We haven't like, got like a fucking octopus thing hanging around. Or...
You know, so it's something that you can conjure up in your head fairly easily. And it is, I wouldn't recommend it. And it seems to be smart.
Mm-hmm.
Which can only be more of a problem for us.
Indeed.
It says that Justin, you know, summoned it or whatever.
Oh, does it?
It says to Harry, it says...
Oh, I love when Harry feels it, like, hating that it is this, like, ancient hate. Mm-hmm. And then he's like, yeah, that thing you sensed, that hate, that's as close as you can understand my actual name.
Oh, my God, that's right. That is correct.
I would love that if I, like, ran into somebody I really hated who couldn't place me. And I was like, do you see the look of complete contempt I'm giving you? This look on my face is my name to you now.
Good Lord.
Enjoy that.
Jesus Christ, lady. The fuck?
Listen, I'm just saying that there are some people that would deserve that, and it would be me being generous.
Oh, I can't find it, but I'm pretty sure he does.
All right. Well, I guess I'm going to leave you.
Yes.
Yeah, let's see. But so Harry gets Stan to leave. And really, I think most of us probably thought that was going to be the last we saw of Stan.
I would have preferred if that had been the last we saw of Stan. Because, you know, Stan did not ask for any of this.
Yeah.
He was just trying to get through a shift and smoked a little bowl. And then all of this nonsense shows up.
And Harry is, like, acutely aware of later how Stan didn't ask for any of this.
Mm-hmm.
And when he meets up with Stan later, it's not entirely clear, but I am assuming he who walks behind fucked up Stan running away and, like, kept him locked in place in some sort of, like, Freddy-ish nightmare, like, bog situation.
Right, right.
Because he's, like, trying to sprint and he's not barely moving at all. Ugh.
Yeah. I had to read that, like, twice because I was thrown off by the description.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I was like, wait, he's doing what?
And I've read this a few times, and I'll be honest, I don't feel like I quite caught that other times because I was just so distracted by this fucking thing. So, yeah, I don't blame you.
When Stan's behind Stan and, like, hugs him.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like three sets of whatever. There's like a set of arms or some kind of tail that comes from around the back.
Yep.
And embraces him so tightly and then just kind of like yanks him apart into three separate pieces. And that was a lot to read.
Yep.
And Harry Dresden is watching this. And for the first time in his life, he is filled with... And it kind of creeps up on him, too, which I really appreciate it. It was like this little voice was like, oh, you can't do that.
Mm-hmm.
That's not right, you know. Somebody should do something about that. Oh, well, I guess I'm somebody. and he tapped into this rage that he didn't know he even had. And uses fire, like fire magic for the first time.
Yeah.
It's pretty cool. And he has some, like, smart-ass things to say about it, too. Something about cutting six period.
And how he's bad at Spanish. Yeah, I really loved the description of Stan's death. And he says, I'd seen death before, but not like that. Yeah. He just sort of changed from a person to an empty pile of meat parts. Soiled cloth. Mm-hmm. I had never seen death come like that, as a humiliation, a reduction of a unique soul to nothing more than constituent matter.
Jesus.
When the creature killed Stan, it didn't simply end his life, it underscored the underlying futility, the ultimate insignificance of that life. Ouch.
My feelings are so hurt.
Right?
And nothing even happened to me. It's fucking... I mean, Jesus Christ.
But we have sort of glossed over the back and forth before we come to Stan. Because there's a whole fucking thing with Harry and Leah talking to each other as well. And the actual, like, confrontation between him and walks behind.
Right, right.
So, let's see. But, yeah, so he sends Stan out. Walks behind is like, you think he's going to go get the cops? Do you think that's going to do anything? Are you serious? And I assure you we will not be disturbed. I've made sure of it. And I was like...
He's just like, I'm not worried about your little friend.
Yeah, pretty much. It does demonstrate you possess a certain talent for performance under pressure, does it not? You sound like my guidance counselor. I guess maybe you are a little scary. Oh, Harry. Oh, you.
Well, he's still working out the kinks in the material.
Yeah, you know. It's not bad. I'm not mad about it. In fact, I'm a little impressed. So, let's see. This is when they go to him and Leah talking. And he asks her how it is that he can remember this so clearly when, if he were still alive, he's pretty certain he wouldn't be able to recall everything this clearly. That he's like fought this. Back on this, and he couldn't recall exactly what the creature said to him.
Mm-hmm.
And how come he can get it all now, like word for word? Basically, she's like, "You're a ghost now, so your dumb brain isn't a problem anymore."
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this idea that we, you know, that the information, memories, or whatever, they never really go anywhere. It's just our ability to like access them.
Mm-hmm.
Is what degrades. And if that is no longer a concern, then everything is just, you know, as clear as day. I can't imagine what it would be like to live that way.
Just recall everything?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, some people have, they used to call it a photographic memory. I don't think you call it that anymore.
Yeah.
But every once in a while, like every 4 or 5 years, there'll be a new cop show about a lady cop who... never forgets anything.
Every man's worst fear, am I right?
It's been like 3 different versions of that show.
I'm somebody who can, like, has pretty excellent recall after just, you know, a conversation or a viewing of a show. I'm pretty good at remembering nearly verbatim what somebody said. But that's a very different thing than, like, your own full memories.
Mm-hmm.
I thought it was neat that she's basically like, this is like the purest form of memory. Like, that's what you are practically as a ghost. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, you can, this is exactly accurate.
I love this question, the way he questioned it, too. He said something like, are memories the truth?
Mm-hmm.
And it's so, I like that phrasing because, you know, in the real world, for those of us, especially me with my terrible ass memory, but the way you remember a thing isn't always exactly how it happened, you know, but you only have like access to the way you remember it. To be able to like look back on something completely objectively, I don't know if I want to see my memories like that.
Right.
What if I'm the bad guy?
Liz Lemon style.
Basically, yes. Yes, exactly.
That is such a good episode.
It really is.
And I have had things like that as well. Because, you know, I'm talking about how good I am at recalling dialogue. And I mean that in life and in properties I've covered. But I have had what I was certain was a memory of this or that. And there is no way that I could be correct based on the evidence. None. I had this happen when I was working at the bank. I was working with this girl next to me, and I could swear that she asked me for a strap of hundreds, and I handed her the strap of hundreds, and I made the ticket for it. I made the ticket for it. I sure did. For a strap of hundreds I never gave her. And she didn't put that into her accounting. So her drawer came up even, but my drawer was $1,000 over. And I couldn't understand it because I distinctly remembered handing her that strap of hundreds. It never happened. There is no reason for me to continue sticking to the story that it happened when her drawer is correct and mine is not. And yet I held on to this false memory as like my proof, even though there was all of this hard evidence in my face. And I could tell that she was, like, a little offended that I thought she had screwed up somehow, instead of just being like, you remember this wrong. Because how could my memory be that wrong? It's like I hallucinated a whole thing. Well, that is what it's like. It is like I hallucinated a whole thing, and there is just nothing to be done about it. That's exactly what it's like. And I just sort of had to, like, end my day knowing that I can have a memory I believe in that much and have it be wrong. And that is a very upsetting thing to know your brain can do to you.
Yeah. Before we started recording, I could have sworn that you texted me like 4 or 5 things. I remember looking at the phone. I remember reading them. I remember what they said. And then I put the phone down, and when I picked it back up, the whole conversation was gone. And you said we didn't have it.
I sure didn't. I don't know what that is that you had.
I could see it. We were talking about getting the fucking Mac Keeper thing.
Mm-hmm.
And then you said you wanted to get it. And then you were like,
I said I would pay for it. And you said, why? And I said, because.
Right? And then you said something like, I sent you to the wrong one, so that was my fault. Let me get this for you. But I just realized I can't because of Christmas. And then you wrote, this whole year has been trash.
I can't because of Christmas?
Yeah, that's what I saw.
I love this. This has, like, the internal logic of a dream. Of just me being like, well, you know how those chickens laid this year, so I'm afraid I won't be able to pay for that computer program anymore. Like, shit that just isn't linked at all, that you're like, no, but that makes sense.
I swear to God, I could see it. It's clear as day. I don't know. Never happened.
This is what I get worried about with getting older. Because eventually your brain just starts to fucking decompose inside your skull and do that shit to you.
That is a horrible image.
I mean, that's what's happening. It's just, it's like, yeah, I'll keep your, like, bodily functions going mostly. But if you expect to be able to, like, recall what happened yesterday, I am sorry. That's not going to happen.
We don't do that anymore.
That's not a luxury you get to have. And, and you know, so many people with dementia, I mean, for them, things that happened 20 years ago just happened.
Well, that's what I mean when I say about, you know, how they say you never really forget anything. You can't get to it. So those memories from 60 years ago were always there, and now they can just pop into them. Well, how come you couldn't just pop into them the whole time?
Because your whole hard drive was like, we don't have space for that right now. We're trying to, like, do a job and get groceries and, you know, feed ourselves. And then you reach a point where, like, you don't have to go to a job anymore. And somebody's just bringing you a tray of food every day. And all of that, like, hard drive space that you needed for, like, living starts to be open and free again.
You know what I hear? I hear I am wasting my life with bullshit, nonsense errands. Like working and grocery shopping.
I mean,
when instead I could just have, like, all my memories intact.
This is why I think that everybody should be anti-capitalism. Imagine what we could do with these old beans of ours if we weren't constantly preoccupied with the basics of surviving. What sort of society could we live in?
Oh, what a world.
What a world it could be. Yeah. So, we go back to, first Leah's just like, because he says again, but are they true? And she's like, bitch, what did I just say? And would I sit here listening to this bullshit if it wasn't true? Yes. Shut up and tell me the story.
She's so insulting.
She's like, stop wasting my time. Ugh, I answered your question. Bored. Get on with it. So, this is when, he gets thrown backward into this, like, shelf of stuff. And his 16-year-old starving brain is like, donuts. That's the thing that he's processing right now, is that it smells delicious.
I love how he also is like, this shit really, really hurt.
Mm-hmm.
Now, old me, I've been banged around so much that this wouldn't be a big deal. But young me, I wasn't ready for this just yet.
Yep. Although he does think a couple times about how, like, the fact that Justin was so hard on him has helped. Because, like, he gets shoved headfirst into the game. And he doesn't fall down. And he's, like, pretty sure he would have. Most people would have. But Justin has been so hard on him that he's able to, like, recover. Which, I mean, I guess.
I mean, you know what? I know that's not the intention of the moment, but I really like to stay away from the ideas about how abuse, you know, makes you stronger. You know,
this is like basically what the Lenashi was saying to Molly when he was spying on them. When Molly's like, Harry would never have done this, and the Lenashi's like, then he fucked up.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's just, it's the kind of thing where I'm like, I mean, I just don't have a good answer, because, yeah, it's abusive, but if you're trying to prepare somebody for going into situations in which they are likely to be abused, and you are trying to make it so that they survive that, I don't really know what the way to do that is and not fuck a person up.
I mean, that's the same sort of mentality they have in a lot of armed forces around the world, You go through this straight-up hazing and abuse sort of situation. Or it can't, you know, maybe not always. To my mind, it always is, but I know people have different opinions on that. But the idea of doing all that so that on the other side of this, they'll be, like, a stronger, better person.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm not saying that it doesn't get results. Clearly it does. We wouldn't still do it. But I think it's ethical.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's fair. Yeah, so you have to be willing to put aside your ethics for results.
Which is very common, actually, turns out.
Mm-hmm. Especially for the she. No problem. Let's see, here it is. Such a useless scrap of meat contains you. It's entirely inconsequential, and yet it molds you. Your existence is a series of contradictions. But here is certainty, mortal child. This time, you cannot run. So Harry keeps trying to run anyway, which I don't blame him for.
Listen, it's called an instinct for a reason.
And he keeps catching him and saying, you can't escape what's always behind you. No one will save you. Child of the stars, I will destroy you this night.
This is a whole lot for a 16-year-old. I just want to remind everybody.
Yeah.
Yeah. Very upsetting. That's that. But yeah, this, I want to talk for just a second about Justin calling this thing and sicking it on Harry.
Okay.
That, to me, feels a little, like, overkill. You know, like, a bit much.
Pun intended.
Oh, my God.
I'm sorry.
that's my bad. you know, to call something this horrifying, this powerful, you know, to go after him when he could have gone after him himself. I'm sure Justin is plenty capable of dealing with Harry.
Mm-hmm.
I don't understand the leap to this.
I think that's fair. Yeah.
But, I mean, I don't really know Justin like that. He doesn't seem like a great guy, so maybe for him it really wasn't a leap.
He doesn't seem like a great guy, you think? Wow, that's harsh, Rashawn.
This thing is really powerful, and I'm not sure I understand why it would be doing the bidding of Justin.
That's a good question, too. Yeah.
You know, I don't understand. Is it like something that he's, like I said, he summoned and sent it after Harry, but I don't know. Maybe he's paying. You know, I don't know. But it just seems like an awful lot. Like, this thing seems like something that Harry would be fighting as an adult.
Mm-hmm.
like this thing has been creeping around in the shadows of these books, you know, for a while now. And it's been daunting to kind of like talk about it as adult Harry. It seems like way too much to be going after a 16-year-old kid.
I'm trying to remember. And I don't think Brendan Holmes sent a message for this week, but I'm checking now just in case, because last time he sent it like while we were recording and it was absolutely perfect timing. No, it doesn't look like it. But Brendan, if you get together some notes for next week, question, I know that in the scene in the caves, and I'm trying to remember which book it is, but in the caves by Wraith Manor, the Deeps, they are doing that ritual to summon a demon of some kind. And this woman is supposed to keep the chant up constantly or else the thing will get really pissed. And something happens, and she has to stop. I don't remember what happens to stop her chanting. But I can't remember if they are summoning he who walks behind or he who walks before, somebody with, like, a similar name. Whatever it is comes out in the shape of, like, this black sort of cloud and shoots down her throat and then expands into spikes.
Right.
And basically, like, skewers and spears her from the inside. And so what I'm saying is, you're asking good questions, because that's the sort of consequence that Justin could be looking at if he were to displease whatever this thing is.
Yeah. I wish I could remember When Lashia was telling Harry about what and where he who walks behind comes from and what it is.
Well, I can ask Brendan Hone to grab those notes, too, if you can, sir. Understand if you aren't able to do it every week. I really do. Trust me. But just in case.
Because now I'm thinking about, like, if this thing is a part of a thing, then that means there's other things.
Mm-hmm.
And then you just brought up what happened at the Deeps. And these things are terrible.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
and that there might be more of them. So I'm not sure how we ended up getting there.
And I feel like Harry, at the time, in the previous story where he is summoned or something like him is summoned, Harry is just kind of like, who gave you the name of this thing? And is like, where did you even find out about this creature? And that is also something that I'm like wanting to know, is where in history or magic does this dude's name come up? That he's apparently somebody that people know. And they're like, yeah, that's a guy that I want on my side. Like, what? I feel like I want to stay the fuck away from that personally myself. That's just me. It's just a kind of, like, hubris, you know, to be like, oh, yeah, this incredibly badass thing. I most certainly want to, like, summon it and give it orders.
Yeah, that's what, you know, exactly. And you bring up, if Justin is not in charge of it, is anything in charge of it? Like, what's the hierarchy from wherever it's from? Like, does it have a boss?
Hmm.
How terrible must its boss be if it exists?
Yeah.
Oh, I don't even want to think about it. I bet it has a rad name, though.
Yeah, I'm a fan of this this naming, what would you call it?
A naming convention?
Convention. Yeah. That doesn't feel right. Because it just feels like, oh, yeah, it's a convention where we all get our names finally. It just feels like an actual event rather than like, you know what I mean? I don't know. And it doesn't quite work when I say it, but I know that's correct. do you get what I mean? I feel stupid now. But yeah, I rather like it.
I'm just thinking about a giant convention where people go to get their names.
Yeah, like we all go like without names until age like 12 or something. And then finally they're like, all right, here's what name suits you now that we know you better.
When you first walk in, there's a table with name tags, but they're all empty and there's no markers. You just put it on and walk around.
Symbolism. What would your name under this convention be?
She Who Sleeps.
That's actually kind of sinister. I like it. Like, there's something about that makes me want to be like, ooh, don't wake her ass up. You know what I mean?
What about yours?
I'm trying to think of one for myself, but I'm coming up empty. I'm She Who Cracks a Joke. Like, that's no good. I'll figure something out.
She Who Tells.
She Who Tells? What, so I can't keep a secret? Is that what that's about? We've talked about this, and no. I'm sorry for that. I thought we were past this.
Oh, Lord.
excuse me. Okay, so... Let's see, I'm trying to... Oh, yeah, he tosses Harry around a whole lot, calls him pathetic and useless. And Harry says, I know you are, but what am I?
Oh, my God. And this fucking Pee Wee Herman voice that comes out of nowhere that I was completely unprepared for.
How did you feel about this?
What is there to think? What is there to say? It is genius.
I mean, it's really the best you can ask for when you're facing down somebody who is so, you are so out of your own weight class and they are not going to be intimidated. You're not going to get off a line.
Mm-hmm.
You may as well go for just straight up confusion.
This is just sort of a last, like, Hail Mary. I'm just going to throw everything I have.
Yeah.
And what I have in my arsenal is this. Because up until this morning, you know, my life wasn't in danger to my knowledge.
What I have in my arsenal is this.
I mean, you know, it's not like he's been training his whole life for this particular, like, epic showdown.
True.
He was making out in the woods with his girlfriend and cutting class and trying to start little mini fires in the fireplace. He's not ready for this. But the fact that he has stayed, even, like, He Who Walks is mentions a couple times, like, you are just here with the shits, aren't you? Like, how odd, how peculiar. You're just like, huh, still haven't gone down yet. All right, cool. It's pretty remarkable.
I'm trying to read. Confession. When I was little, Pee Wee Herman scared the shit out of me.
Oh, no, that's a shame.
I found him incredibly creepy.
I love Pee Wee Herman.
He felt like, to me, the caricature of a predator, first of all. So he just felt like a pedophile. The aesthetic of his home was Tim Burton-y acid trip. And his voice was awful. And so everything about his whole vibe... And then there's Large Marge, which is like a literal nightmare situation. All of it I hated. So, you're going to have to tell me, is the voice basically like a high pitch, like, I know you are, but what am I? Like, how, what does this sound like?
That, pretty much that.
Really? That's it?
Pretty much. I'm not going to like do, no.
When he says, ha ha, is it like the guy from The Simpsons who says that?
No, no, it's not a Nelson ha ha. It's actually like a lower pitch maybe is the word, lower register.
So what's that like?
I'm not doing that either.
Come on, just do the ha ha, that's nothing.
Nope.
Rashawn.
I'll send you a clip.
That is pathetic. Pitiful. Ugh. Disgusted. You could watch it, this trash. But then you can't even have the courtesy to explain it to me.
It is trash is so harsh.
Oh, well. So, yeah, Harry is at this point when he's like, oh, you know what I could do? I could just spin. I struggled to my feet and started down the aisle, spinning with every step, whirling dervish style. The whole time, I heard myself spewing Pee-wee Herman's cartoony laugh, which in retrospect was possibly the creepiest thing to hit my ears that night. So this is when Stan gets ripped into three parts and Harry snaps into Avenger mode.
Yeah, yeah.
And he does the fuego. It wasn't mm-hmm. right. Somebody ought to do something about it.
Yep.
And
I love that moment.
Yeah, he goes for it with fuego and lights the... Like, it's basically... He's like, yeah, so... All gas stations have some safety measures built in. And that's super.
Right? That's great. That's been working out great for us. We appreciate that.
But however. They are not ready for this jelly. And that shit explodes. And he who walks behind is very salty.
Yeah. Just... All right. So... What does he scream? How dare?
How dare you raise your hand to me? How dare you raise your hand against me? Sir?
What have we been doing the last 20 minutes?
All you did was talk about what a weak little fucking waste of a worm body he was. It sounded like this is what you wanted.
Right? Like you've been throwing my ass around for 20 minutes.
Yeah.
Of course I'm gonna raise a hand.
Like, what were you trying to motivate in him? Or was it not for that? Was it just you talking to yourself? Maybe that's it. Maybe I'm thinking of it as him trying to be like, you fuck, get up, do it. But instead it was just him, like, you know, out loud being like, what a loser, look at this. Ugh, lame.
Like creature.
Yeah, you know, like, maybe he's just... that kind of bored. And he thought he was just going to have a good time fucking with somebody today, and it got ruined.
I mean, he did take a certain amount of enjoyment and got really interested once Harry started fighting back.
That's what I thought.
Yeah, right? So, this might feel like trickery. Like, this is what we were doing.
Maybe it's like, well, it was fun when you were fighting back. I didn't say you could win.
Basically.
I said you could give me a little bit of a challenge. Did you see that Reddit post about the guy who was super mad that his girlfriend didn't let him win at bowling?
Oh my God, I did. I did.
He who walks behind is that dude.
Oh my God.
He like Christ. Makes Harry... do this fight that he didn't even want. And then when Harry's good at it, he's like, well, what the fuck?
He's just gonna leave Harry at the gas station and go home, man.
Right? Guys, for those of you who didn't see what we're talking about, there was an Am I the Asshole post where this guy basically, like, made his girlfriend come to his friend's outing where they always go bowling, even though she didn't really want to go. And then she turned out to be super good at bowling, which he didn't anticipate. And he wanted her to let him win finally because she won too many times. And she tried to let him win, but he was so bad that even her trying to throw the game wasn't enough for him to actually win a game. And after forcing her to come, he pretended to go to the bathroom when they were all eating dinner and left her there.
Oh, my God.
With his friends. And went on the, am I the ass? It wasn't even like, am I the asshole for leaving her? It was, am I the asshole for expecting my girlfriend to apologize for embarrassing me in front because of my friends?
When she got home, he was still mad at her and crying, like, even after he left her there.
Yep. Yeah, he confessed that he was, like, crying in the bathroom before he left.
Oh, my God, yeah. None of the other guys' girlfriends beat them. You should want to lose to help me look better.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, it was just gross. Why are men?
It's one of those where I'm like, I really hope that this is fake. Because if there's a real person out there acting like this, I don't want to live in this world. I don't like it. I didn't agree to this. But, yeah, so what I'm saying is he who walks behind is bowling boyfriend. And I am sticking with that forever.
Bowling boyfriend.
So we pop back to Harry talking to Leah. And he says something about how if I hadn't cut class that day, I don't know if I would have become what I did. And she's like, well, I mean, I guess that's the thing that you could focus on.
Weird.
And she's like, you were being prepared to be an enforcer. And Harry's like, well, Justin never tried to get me to hurt anyone. And she says, why would he wish you to be armed against him before he was certain of your loyalty?
Common fucking sense, Harry.
Look, Harry.
Don't make her spell everything out. She has more important things to do than that.
And he tries to be like, well, there's really no way to know. And she's like, yeah, there is. There's a way to know, which is that he is trash and you know it. He was trash. He sent a thing to kill you. Convincing a young mortal to believe that it is right and proper to use magic for violence is a delicate process and one that cannot be rushed.
Spoken like someone who's got a lot of experience doing it.
Spooky. You would like to believe that perhaps Justin had hidden good intentions of some sort, that what happened between you was some kind of misunderstanding, but you understood him perfectly. I'm sorry, Harry.
Yeah. That's like that last brutal moment. Just like, let me have this one little thing that I keep secret, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And then somebody being like, no, you don't get to keep that.
Yeah.
I'm going to need you to face 100% of the truth. Nobody wants to face that much truth.
No.
Not 100% of it. At one time, get out of here.
Like, part of me feels like that's why he even asked, are memories truth? Because he's trying to be like, well, how right is this, though, really? I will say, though, throughout that thing, I don't feel like he who walks behind says that he was sent. I couldn't find the line. If it is there and I just missed it, I'm sure somebody will let me know. So we'll find out. But, okay, so, Harry has, let's see, two more questions to ask, because our memory's truth was one of his questions. And he asks for a bit of time to think some things over. And he finally settles on what his priorities have to be right now, because it's super tempting to ask questions about his past. And he says something like, I was sent back to find my killer. I'm supposed to be hunting down whoever killed me, and yet I've been doing a whole lot of everything but that. In point of fact, Leah said, you've been doing little else.
Mm-hmm. Cryptic.
He says, oh, you bitch. I love that so much. That's one of my favorite parts, honestly, is him just flat out saying to Leia, "Oh, you bitch." You love doing that to me, especially considering how often Harry does this to literally everybody else.
Yes, right? But he's not a drop of self-awareness in this moment, I don't think.
Harry, come on. That's your whole thing, is to just not tell people shit. Come on, stop it.
I mean, all your friends tell you about it.
Yep.
They've all mentioned it to you that you do this.
But it's fun, I guess. So he finally asks, what's the deal with the corpse taker? What are her resources? What are her goals? And she's basically like, all she wants is what she wants. She's not working for anybody. She's not here for a team. She doesn't have, like, ideals. She just wants to get a body back and be able to fuck people over.
Yep.
And do whatever she feels like doing.
She wants to be able to pick up where she left off.
Mm-hmm.
And she needs a body that will have some capabilities that she can use her powers.
Mm-hmm.
And poor Mort is, I guess, you know, one of her best options.
I thought this was really interesting because he's like, so she needs somebody with magical capability. And she's like, not just magical capability. She needs significant capability because she was able to jump from body to body before as a sort of consciousness because she was still technically mortal, like on the mortal coil, as she puts it. But now she's dead. So it's a lot harder. So she has to find somebody who's really good already, and she can then get where she was. And when he asks about Mort, and he's like, so he's significant? She says, in certain respects, he is more potent than you were.
Yeah.
Which is just saying surprising. A whole lot. Right?
I don't know exactly. I mean, my assumption is it's got to be about, you know, his powers, you know, to deal with the dead. Well, it doesn't have to be, but that's what I would think, because that's his main focus.
Mm-hmm.
But, so you could have, like, an entirely different discipline and be more powerful than Harry, and it just wouldn't look that way, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because of Harry's whole, like, making stuff go boom all the time, which is very impressive. And I don't know why she has to do this in Chicago. I guess because that's where she was killed?
Let's see. I'm trying to find what... Because he asks that question. Why risk it in the first place? Why Chicago? And she says, I do not know, but the Fomor are dangerous folk with whom to make bargains. Oh, right. So, yeah, that's we don't know why she has to do it here.
Yeah. And she tells a little bit about who the Fomar are.
Mm-hmm.
And apparently they have a long history with the Fae and were enemies.
Yeah.
And had been exiled. And they just sort of grouped up, which is what happens when you exile a bunch of fucking terrible people.
Indeed. That keeps happening.
You can't just let them be mingling all willy-nilly, fraternizing and shit, because 100% of the time they will come up with an evil scheme. That's what got them banished in the first place. I don't understand. So that's what's happened, and now the Fomar are a thing and a force to be reckoned with.
The Fomar are a weird thing because they're like in mythology.
As, are they?
Yeah, against, like, the fairy, basically. And in everything that I read, they're, like, depicted really differently. I just read a series, the Young Wizard series for Spoil Me, and there's, like, a whole battle against the Fomor. And they have a very different vibe. Because we've met some of the Fomor in this with, like, Murphy's story, where... You know, they're stealing people with magical talent and, you know, God knows. So, yeah, it's just they come up in a variety of things, but they're They are sort of like other things, like werewolves and vampires and stuff, where there are a lot of unclear bits of folklore, so people just play around and, like, do what they want with them, you know?
Wow. Huh.
But, yeah, I find that interesting, because I just, like, was reading this long before I did Young Wizards, and I had forgotten that the Fomor are, like, a whole thing when I was reading this. And then when I got to that part in Young Wizards, I was like, oh my God, right. Why did it take this to remind me? And I think it's just because in the context of that story, it's a much more direct, like, here are fairies, here are Fomor kind of thing. And in this, it's, they creep up on you. Mm-hmm. And Harry doesn't, like, have direct contact with them as such. Like, it's just his friends who are the ones who keep running into them, you mm-hmm. know? So it's a sort of, like, yeah.
Secondhand, yeah.
So I think that's why it, like, kind of failed to register with me exactly what the hell they are. And even when she says, like, oh, yeah, historically we've had a lot of conflicts with them, still did not hit. So, yeah, basically he's like, well, how can I get her back out again if she gets Morty? And she's like, lol, that's not how that goes. If she gets in there, you could kill him. And, I mean, she could go into somebody else. So really, that really wouldn't super work either. And so he's like, all right, so I just have to get her before she gets Morty. And then, two questions have been answered. Your third? I thought some more. Somehow, I doubted that saying, say, who killed me, would yield any comprehensible results. On the other hand, what the hell? You never know until you try. Say, I asked, who killed me?
I was so happy he decided to just ask that.
Right?
They never do it in the books. Mm-hmm. They never, ever have them just ask the fucking obvious question.
Yep.
I enjoyed that so much. And even though we're risking her answering us in circles and not getting anything this useful, I don't even care. I'm so proud of him for just asking the fucking question.
I have to confess that the first time I read this, that question did not even enter my head.
Really?
I think that I thought she wouldn't know.
Hmm. I mean,
I, like, assumed. There's no evidence to point to that she
okay.
doesn't know. But I just, for some reason, I was just like, I mean, if Leah knows who killed him, wouldn't she have fucking done some shit about it? Because he was under contract at that point. You know? So I would think right. that somebody comes after your contracted person, and that's an issue for you. So if that has not been managed, to our knowledge, then they don't know.
Right.
But that's operating under the assumption that if it were managed, we would have heard or known about it.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess it could be somebody that isn't, like, in the circle that Harry has seen so far. But, yeah, I think I thought that, like, there was no point asking because she didn't know. And
right.
I don't know why I thought that.
My assumption is that if they know, which I would imagine they do, whoever is behind it, they either have some kind of pre-existing thing with that they can't really break, or whoever it is tied somehow into a pact they have with someone else that they can't break. I can't explain, like, what the Fae are doing, I just think, oh, it must be some really complicated legal Fae shit. That we'll find out about, you know, at the end, where it's like, oh, you know, we wanted to help you, but we couldn't because, you know, this and that.
Right. Yeah, I guess that makes sense.
I found the thing about Justin, and I misread. So he doesn't say Justin sent him, he tells Harry that he expected a better pupil of De Morn.
Ah.
That's what it is. So it doesn't really say that Justin sent him at all, but he knows who Harry is and, you know, he knows who Justin is. So, yeah, now that opens things up a little bit for me because I was operating under the assumption that, you know, it was a fact that Justin had sent them. And I had all those questions about, like, well, why would you pick this type of thing to do it? But it would be a hell of a coincidence, but it's possible that it doesn't have anything to do with Justin at all. It has more to do with that name that he called him, that Child of Stars. Like, maybe there's a whole plot going on with where Harry was born or when he was born. Or maybe it's as easy as who he was born to. That set some shit in motion that I don't even know about yet. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
When you start introducing information about or reminding us about the condition that he was born in, and that weird name, if like it feels like it's signaling something. So,
well, yeah. I mean, it does seem like highly coincidental. But
I mean, it'd be weird, right, for this thing to show up to try to kill him on the very same day that he, you know, ran from Justin. Yeah, that seems like a big coincidence.
And the fact that he knows who Justin is. He doesn't say he sent me, but he knows who he is, and that also feels significant. So, yeah. And I feel like Harry has to think that's what it is. Because Harry references Justin trying to kill him. So, unless there's a whole other thing that happened, which is certainly possible, my assumption is this is what he's talking about.
I feel like, I can't remember for real, but the very first time we hear about He Who Walks Behind, doesn't Harry just flat out say it's the thing that Justin sent to kill me or something?
He might. I don't remember.
Yeah. But I feel like the whole time I've been reading, I've been operating like, yeah, he sent that shit. We all know he sent that shit.
And it is the kind of thing that, like, if Harry said that, we can certainly, take from that that's what Harry thinks happened.
True. Doesn't mean it's actually what happened.
Yeah.
Oh, right. God damn unreliable memories.
So, yeah, I don't know. I find this to be, like, a fascinating bit of his backstory that, like I said, it's bonkers to me that it takes us this long to get here and find out this story. Every time that I go back through this series, I forget how long it is that we know Harry, that we literally don't find out about this until after Harry is dead. What? To me, that's a kind of patience that, as a writer, I don't know that I could have that. I feel like this is the sort of shit I'd want to lay out in the first book to get everybody to know my character better. And I feel like this is a very effective thing to do, to wait like this. I think it works. But my instinct would be to lay it all out on the table right away. And it shows what I know.
Right. It's a really interesting choice to have us get to know a character in the present time without learning what any of the motivations may be for the behavior that we see as the adult. And then going back to it and, like, filling in the blanks as opposed to building up everything that happened in the childhood beginning of the story. And then, like, building the adult on top of that foundation.
Yeah.
I'm enjoying this kind of piecing the puzzle.
Agreed. So, before we wrap up, I wanted to mention, a lot of you have been sort of wondering if I was going to review Battleground the way that I did Peace Talks with Krista, who is a co-host on, right now, what she's doing with Jamie is Vampire Diaries. And Krista has read all of the books. She did the same thing with this series that she did with Song of Ice and Fire, where she started like 12 books in.
Jesus.
But she is a huge Dresden fan, has a lot of the same criticisms that we have of the series, but, you know, still a major fan and is in all of the groups and stuff on Facebook. And frequently she and I will find ourselves in the same thread just laughing at somebody. And she has agreed to do Battleground with me, and I'm going to be doing that at about, let's see, what did I say with her? 2 p.m. Central Standard Time on Saturday, January 16th. So those of you who are interested in attending, I'll be posting the Crowdcast link for the event. If you don't see that link, because Facebook has algorithms that make you not see stuff, Twitter has algorithms that make you not see stuff, my recommendation is to go to unspoiledpodcast.com. There will be a link. I think it's just like a picture of me on the mic, and it says, click here for live events. And if you go there and register for Crowdcast and sign up for like notifications from us, you'll get a notification that like for that event, you will get a notification. If you register for the event specifically and go to our events page, registering through Crowdcast specifically is a really good way to actually make it to the event instead of depending on fucking Facebook and Twitter and whatnot.
That's what I do.
It's just, it's really the only way. I probably, at this point in my career, should start working on a newsletter and doing something like that a little bit more consistently so that I could put this info out. But I gotta tell y'all, I don't read newsletters when they show up in my email.
Nobody does.
So I kind of feel like it's a massive waste of my time.
Yeah, nobody reads those.
It just feels like I may as well just say it on the thing and tell y'all how to get there and what to do, and that'll be easier for us all. So, yeah, like I said, it's go to unspoiledpodcast.com, go to live events, and you can register for notifications for all Unspoiled Crowdcasts. I would recommend against that because I do a lot of them.
It's true. You guys don't want to just select all and keep it moving.
Yeah.
I mean, you absolutely can. You're grown, but
I would but just be ready. Because the last thing I want is for you to like register for notifications for this event, get annoyed from the 30 notifications you get that don't relate to the event, turn off notifications, and then miss the event, which is what would happen to me. So, yeah, you can go in and like go through the events that are listed coming up, upcoming, and scroll down to the Battleground one and just register for that specifically. And then you'll just get a reminder email with the link, like, you know, 20 minutes before it starts or whatever. And I'll also, like I said, will post it on Facebook and Instagram and Twitter. But I just don't recommend putting all your eggs in them social media baskets. That's all I'm saying. So
I cannot believe this friggin' what is that new app called that you asked me about? I forget that fast.
I don't know what you're talking about.
The Rooms, John.
The Rooms, John.
Yeah, the new social media thing.
Parler?
No, not the fucking racist, John. The exclusive one. The one you have to be invited to.
Oh, Clubhouse.
To. Yes.
Mm. Nightmare. Nightmare shit. You have to talk to people, guys. Strangers.
I don't understand.
Be on sound on the phone with people you don't know and like hope and maybe a celebrity shows up to make it worth your while.
And people are having conversations and you just sort of, I guess, pop in and listen and decide if you want to join in.
No, thank you. Get all I need in that regard. Like, well, I guess I don't with COVID, but I was going to say in restaurants when you just hear somebody like starting to go off in the next booth and you and your significant other just stop talking and look at each other and then you just fucking listen to that for the next 20 minutes. That is my Clubhouse.
You both make that face that Will Smith gives.
I love that kind of moment when you hear some shit that you're like, I did not just hear that. Did I just hear that? And then they go and say something even crazier. And you're like, oh my God, I must have heard that because that other shit is even worse. And you really wish you could rewind. But anyway, yeah, so January 16th, 2 p.m. Central Standard Time. Hopefully that makes it in a, like, I tried to schedule it during a point in the day where, like, no matter what time zone you're in, it won't be totally unreasonable. Unless you're Australian. If you're Australian, I'm sorry. Nothing I can do will make it better for you. It's just gonna fucking be rough for you any time of day. So I try my best. God, I often wonder, like, we talk a lot about fleeing the United States for other countries.
We do.
And there's a lot about that that's appealing. And then I remember shit like that. Like, I would love to go live in New Zealand, but then I would be on the exact opposite time as everybody else, and how difficult that would be. Or, like, I wanted to order something and shipping is $6, except to me it's now $27, and it will take 4 weeks to get here. Shit like that, that really makes me sort of reconsider, how much do I want healthcare?
Listen, if I'm going over there, I'm readjusting my whole shit. I am fully committing to being on that side of the world.
So you just are going to leave everybody behind?
Everybody.
Okay, noted.
I'm not fine. All my social media, you know, all my friends, everything. It's... Order takes 4 weeks. I won't order from the place that's not in Australia.
Wow. All right.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
I mean...
It'd be okay.
I guess if you're going to do it, you may as well fucking do it. Like, I guess I admire that. I don't feel like I have quite, come to terms with the fact that that is something that would be required of me. I would really like to just be able to up and move and retain all of my privileges and conveniences of being a pig of an American.
That might be the whitest thing I've ever heard you say. Mm-hmm.
I really felt the whiteness right there coming out there. Can't I just get healthcare and free shipping? Tragic.
I mean, Bezos could afford to do both. That's a conversation for a different day.
I really want a remake of The Christmas Carol with Jeff Bezos as Scrooge. Like, it's not obviously Jeff Bezos cast as Scrooge, but it's a lookalike actor who's obviously meant to be Jeff Bezos, who is Scrooge, and everybody knows precisely what's going on.
Like Jenna Jorp. He won't be Jeff Bezos.
His name will be, well, maybe, let's see, we'll call him Jeff G-E-O-F-F. Benzos. But otherwise, pretty much the same. Jeff Benzos. All right, guys. Thank you again so much for listening. Reminder that next week there will not be an episode because for us, next week is Christmas week. So we will be taking that week off. The week after, Rashawn is going to be moving. So it remains to be seen if there will be an episode at all for next week as well. I will keep you all posted again on the social medias. If you don't see the answer, I apologize. It's not my fault. I try to tell us everybody things and I'll pin it to the top of the Facebook page. I don't know, but I'll keep you posted and we'll see what we can work out. And eventually we'll see you again. I promise. We'll be back. Toodaloo, motherfuckers.
Bye, guys.
was an Unspoiled Network podcast.